Well, it's good that we are able to gather together this morning to worship the Lord and to come together and give him praise and honour for all his mercies and for all his grace toward us. Now, we want to sing together, "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, my great Redeemer's praise." And I trust that you use at least the one tongue you have to give him praise and to give him thanks this morning as we gather in his name. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing.
Thank you.
Well, as we gather this morning to worship him, we want to come in prayer and just seek the face of our God this morning and look to him for his blessing. Our Father, we thank you that it is our great privilege and joy this morning to come into your house on this lovely Sunday morning to give praise, thanks, adoration to your lovely name, the name that is truly above all other names, the name of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you that we can bow in adoration and praise. And thank you, Lord, that ever you loved us, that ever you give yourself for us. Lord, we didn't deserve it. But we thank you, Father, that you have given us what we didn't deserve. You have given us your mercy. You have given us your love. You have showed us Calvary. You have brought to us the wonderful message of salvation. And we can readily partake of the gospel feast because Jesus paid it all. All to him we owe. We thank you, our Father, that the great message of the gospel is all paid in full. And we can come, Lord, and accept and receive salvation full and free. Salvation purchased for us at the cost of precious blood. And so, Lord, we return thanks to you today. And we pray, our Father, for everyone gathered in this house and in the back room and in the cars. And we pray, our Father, that everyone will know the special touch of your Spirit upon them. We ask you, Lord, that you'll bless every home and every family represented. We pray, our Father, for our younger families as well. We ask you, Father, to keep your hand upon them in these days of difficulty for young people growing up in the society that we live in. Lord, we pray that you will protect them. We pray, our Father, that you'll help them to discern between right and wrong, between the right company and the wrong company. And, O God, we ask you that indeed they might honor you and grow up, Lord, to show appreciation for the things of God. So, Lord, bless them, we ask. And our Father, we pray for our country in all its need, how much we need you, Lord, in these days. And as we think of the mission coming up shortly, we call out to you, Lord, and pray for blessing. Pray, Lord, for the outpouring of your Spirit. And pray, Lord, that many precious souls will be brought from darkness into light and from the kingdom of Satan into the kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask you for your blessing upon your work in other parts of the world. We thank our Father of our missionary friends who are laboring to bring the gospel to those who are in darkness. And we think of those, Lord, that are studying languages. We think, oh God, of Gemma this morning. And we think of the Webbers. We pray, Father, that you'll bless them both as they seek to learn a difficult language. Lord, bless them, we pray, and keep your gracious hand upon them. And we pray, Lord, very particularly for the situation there in Ukraine. Father, how that country needs you at this time. We thank you, Lord, for your people in the country. Lord, bless them, we pray. Lord, keep your hand upon them and protect them, Lord. Even little congregations gathering this morning, oh God, be near to them. Cover them and protect them, Lord. In your love we ask of thee. And oh God, we ask you that it would please you to stop this tyrant that is out to wreck and to ruin and to push in every direction. Oh God, we ask you that in your mercy that you would step in, Lord, and that you would undertake. Lord, to this end, we do pray for those churches in Ukraine and the neighboring countries that are taking in refugees and all that is associated with that. We pray, O God, for your help for everyone. And Lord, bless all that are seeking to help today in that dreadful situation. We trust you, Lord, to work and to move by your Spirit. We pray, oh God, that you'll bless our own service. Bless Pastor Samuel as he opens to us the Word of God this morning. We pray, our Father, that your power and that your blessing will freely flow amongst us and that your name will be honored and glorified for Jesus' sake. Amen. I'm going to sing again, My Worth Is Not in What I Own, and another little piece, Lord, You Have My Heart. Just remain seated.
Thank you.
Well, we give you all a very warm welcome to the service this morning. Appreciate you coming and trust the Lord's help and blessing upon us as we gather in his worthy name today. Just a few announcements for you. Do remember the evening service this evening, the evening gospel service, and Brian and Ruth Agnew will be coming along to minister in song this evening, and I will be speaking on the subject of the rapture of the church. And surely in the days we're living in, we must be pretty close to that great event. So that'll be the subject this evening, and Children's Church as well. And then after the evening service, there will be a time of prayer in the back hall for the mission coming up. So do please remember that, and if you can come, we understand if you have children it's difficult, but if you can come and wait for that extra time of prayer, we'll certainly appreciate that very much. Also, on Monday night, there's another Zoom prayer meeting for Ukraine and with SGA, so do please remember that on Monday night. There will be three pastors filling us in on things. A pastor from Ukraine, a pastor from Moldova. Actually, Peter, he was here in the church some years back. He will be on, and also one from Romania. And that will be at 7:30. Now, if you were on the Zoom last week, you will have automatically got the necessary link for the meeting. So if you weren't on last week and you would like to go on this week, you need to email the office, email, and this is the email address for the Slavic office, and then they'll forward you the link. So the office email is just office, and the little symbol for at, sga.org.uk. That's office at sga.org.uk. So do please do that. It'd be good to get on and just hear the up-to-date situation on the refugees and the situation there in Ukraine itself, and to pray for that. Then on Tuesday morning, footsteps at 9:30, and then at 10:30 will be a Zoom prayer meeting again for those who can join with us. So that's at 10:30, a Zoom prayer meeting for the mission. The CEF class at 7:30 in the evening. Then on Wednesday is our Bible study and prayer meeting at 8 o'clock, and there'll be an extended time of prayer for anyone who can wait after the ordinary time of prayer. So there'll be that extended time for the mission as well. Then on Friday night will be the Lifeliners at 7, and there will be a prayer meeting on Zoom at 8 o'clock, as was last week, for the mission. Then on Saturday night is the Haven Youth Meeting on Saturday night, and that's with David Cranson speaking on the subject of mental health, and that's at 8 o'clock. So young people, do let others know about it. Encourage them to come on Saturday night to the back hall. Do your very best to send out those text messages and get others to join with you. Then next Sunday, the Sunday School and Bible class at 10:40, the morning worship service at 11:30, when Keith and Claire will be having their little girl Annabella dedicated. And then on Sunday night at 6:30, the evening gospel service. Also, as was announced last week, there's the offering for the Ukraine crisis, and SGA will be handling that money. They don't keep any but they'll send it all on to the respective situations where it's most needed. So if you can keep that in mind, there's that offering, both services today, but do please put it in an envelope or let somebody know. If you haven't got an envelope with you and you want to do that, let somebody else know about what you're putting in, namely the treasurer or ourselves here. We can pass on that message. And then the Alert magazine is there at the door as well. Also, I'd like to thank you, Ruth and myself would like to thank you for your prayers during Ruth's accident and the aftermath of that, getting the hip replacement and getting everything into place. And she thanks the Lord for the fact that she's feeling a lot better and will be back as normal next week. So do please continue to remember her. And also thank you so much for your prayers. And there was just so many things of Meals on Wheels and gifts and phone calls and text messages. And we do appreciate, and the cards as well. We appreciate all that. Thank you for your love and kindness. Now, I think that's all by way of announcements. And we will turn to another hymn together. And during that hymn, the boys and girls will go out to their Sunday school. That's When Upon Life's Billows, You're Tempest Tossed, When You Are Discouraged, Thinking All Is Lost. So let's stand together and the boys and girls go out at that time. And then Pastor Samuel will be coming to bring us the Lord's Word after that. Thank you. Let's just bow together for a moment's prayer to remember those who are not able to get out and so on. Let's just pray for them. Our Father, we thank you for the fact that we are able to be here this morning. We don't take that for granted. We thank you, God, for that fact. And we pray for any who cannot be here. We ask you for your blessing upon them. We pray, our Father, for our brother Jim Kerr, our sister Mrs. Wright, and Sirlin Barbara Miller, Sadie Lee. We pray, O God, for all of these folks and any others, Lord, that are laid aside at this time. We pray that they might know your touch and your blessing and your help. We also pray for Denise Edwards, the death of her granny. We ask you, O God, that you will help her even today at the funeral. We pray that they might know your help, feel your presence, and just know your nearness at this time of bereavement. So, Father, we just commend ourselves to you now as we continue on in this service to hear your word, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
If you have your Bibles this morning, could we turn to Psalm 95? Psalm 95. Vladimir Putin was born into a poor family on the 7th of October 1952. His father was a mechanic who was an atheist. His mother was a homemaker who was a devout Orthodox Christian. And yet over time he has risen to become one of the most powerful men of this modern world. So much so that a recent newspaper carried the headline, "Putin thinks himself as second only to God." Putin thinks himself as second only to God. Does Putin not know that he is but created dust? Do we understand that? Because over the past 10 days, there has been much fear of Putin's power, but little talk about the power of God. Oh, the world is terrified of Putin's power. But folks, there's a greater power, the power of God. And so therefore, because our newspapers and our news feeds will not speak about it, I feel a burden on my heart to share this morning on the God of Putin. For my friend, the fear and awe of God is a neglected subject. That holy awe and reverence that ought to characterize our coming to our great God. J.I. Packer once remarked, our faith is so feeble, our worship is so flabby, because we have lost the sense of the sheer greatness of God. For sadly, whenever men no longer fear God, they transgress his laws without hesitation. Whenever the fear of consequences no deterrent, when the fear of God is gone, people do what they like, when they like. And the remarkable thing is about fearing God is that whenever you fear God, you fear no one else. Because the fear of God is the greatest antidote to the fear of man. It is only the fear of God who can deliver us from the fear of man. Perhaps we fear man so much because we fear God so little. My friend, as we come to Psalm 95, do you have a holy awe and reverential fear for the God of glory? Do you stand in awe this morning that he governs the creation in the palm of his hand? If not, I trust that God might magnify himself in your life this morning as we look at this tremendous psalm. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the deep places of the earth. The strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart as the day of provocation, as in the day of temptation in the wilderness. When your fathers tempted me, proved me and saw my work. 40 years long was I grieved with this generation and said, it is a people that do err in their heart, and they have not known my ways, unto whom I swear in my wrath that they should not enter into my rest. The writer of the Hebrews, citing this psalm in chapter 4, verse 7, states that King David is the author. We do not know the particular reason that propelled David to write this psalm, but the image that we're given is of a group of people going up to the temple of God, and they're encouraging each other to rise to an occasion to get ready for an event. What is the event? The worship of our great God. Psalm 95 is all about worship. It is an invitation to worship. Verse 1, O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Worship is what we were made for. If you look at the Westminster Catechism of Faith, it'll ask, what is man's chief end? The reply is, man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. That's what we were made for. A.W. Tozer once said, there is nothing I enjoy more than worshipping God. There is nothing I enjoy more than worshipping God. But can that be said of you? Not just on a Sunday, but on a Monday, worshipping the Lord in the beauty of holiness. On the Tuesday, worshipping the Lord in spirit and in truth. On the Wednesday, worshipping the Lord with sacrifices of praise. You see, if there's a lack of spiritual worship in your heart, it is a sign of a spiritual sickness. And therefore, anything that would interfere with your worship this morning must go. It must be removed from your heart. Now, the psalmist, he grasps the greatness of God. And that's why he gives to us, firstly, a call to worship in verse 1. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. The psalmist calls the congregation to sing, because the people of God have always been a singing people. Moses, whenever he was delivered, and the people of Israel from the land of Egypt, they sang in Exodus 15, verse 1. Deborah, whenever the people of God were delivered from the Canaanites, she sang. King David is known as a man who is always singing. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, sings of God's grace. And the question is, not has God given me a voice, but has God given me a song? And if you're truly born again of the Spirit of God, there will be a song in your heart, the song of the bird set free. That is why the psalmist could say in Psalm 40, verse 3, and he hath put a new song in my heart, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and shall magnify the Lord. My, if you're walking with God, you don't sing to impress the person beside you, but you sing as an overflow of the grace of God in your heart. Come, let us sing. One time, whenever I was in Edinburgh as a pilgrim, I went to a church, and it's called Charlotte's Chapel. And the man beside me, he was singing with great gusto. And here's the words he was singing. La, 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 la. La, 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 la. And that's how he went on. And the louder I sang, the louder he laughed. And he laughed and he laughed and he laughed. But that was his heart overflowing with the goodness of God. And that's the only word he could express his worship was la. When Adam and Eve sinned and rebelled against God in the Garden of Eden, what could God say? He said, go. And he sent them out. And yet here in verse 1 is an invitation, come. Come and have communion with me. Come and have worship with me. Come and enjoy my presence. The God who banished mankind from his presence now invites us to come. It is, of course, the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 11. Come unto me, all you who are labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now worship God in the reality of his person. Oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise. Worship God in the reality of his person to the rock. Notice it is not a rock, but it is the rock. And the rock that David speaks of here is the rock of a cliff face. where a little sparrow would go in the time of a storm, and he would lodge there until the storm would blow over. And likewise, David, he's saying here that the Christian, that God is the Christian's rock face. That in a time of storm, when our backs are against the wall, that we run into this rock that is stable when you are unstable, that is strong when you are weak, that is sufficient when you are insufficient. Run to the rock this morning. The psalmist David could say in Psalm 18, verse 2, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my salvation." He could later on then say in Psalm 28, verse 1, "Unto thee will I cry, O Lord of my rock." Yes, the rock, it speaks of strength. Yes, it speaks of stability. But it also speaks of a tenderness, a compassion, and seen none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. Dear child of God, isn't it wonderful in times of anxiety? Times when we're so overwhelmed with the situation around us that we can run to the rock face, that we can find refuge, that we can find relief for our soul, that the world around us might crumble, but the rock that we cling to never shakes, and it never will. Edward Mote was a writer of hymns. And one day as he was in his study, he started to get this beautiful hymn composed together. He penned out four verses of it whenever a friend came in and says to him, "Edward, one of your dear friends is dying." And so he got that slip of paper and he folded it up and he put it in his breast pocket. As he got to that bedside of his dear friend who was dying, she said to him, "Edward, could you sing me a hymn?" He looked around and couldn't see any hymn book, but he knew that there was a hymn in his breast pocket. And so he took that hymn out and he sang it to her. And the lines of that hymn go like this: "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand." He is our rock, but he's also our Redeemer, the rock of our salvation in verse 1. The Old Testament prophets, they looked forward to the coming Messiah. They preached about it. They prayed about it. They prophesied about it. They looked in anticipation to this one who would deliver them from the body of sin. But now we look back, we see more clearly who it is. It's the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who destroyed the prince of the power of the air, who delivered us from sin and from Satan. What a Savior. Let me ask you, is he your Savior? Has there been a moment in your life when you've come before Calvary, you've bowed your foot at that old rugged cross, admitting that you're a terrible sinner, but that he's a wonderful Savior? My, if Putin does not confess Christ on this earth, one day he will bow before the judge of all the world. Philippians chapter 2 reminds us that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things on earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is God, the Father of all. Worship God in the reality of his person, but also worship God in the reality of his presence in verse 2. "Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with psalms." David is saying that our worship should be done with a conscious sense of the presence of God. That we are not singing into open air. That we are not praying and our prayers are hitting the ceiling. But this morning as we meet, we do so in the name of Jesus. That God is in this building. He is in their presence when we come to worship him. The presence of God is such the essential part of worship. This is illustrated to us in the incident with the golden calf. Whenever Moses told the Lord in Exodus 33, verse 15, "If thy presence go not with us, carry us not up thither." And the Lord said to Moses, "My presence shall go with thee, and I shall give thee rest." He knew how vital it was to have the presence of God beside him as he was going to lead those 2 million people out of Egypt into the promised land. Although we are fewer in number, we would still be attempting the impossible and wasting our time each week if God was not present in this building. But we praise our mighty God that he is. Psalm 22 verse 3, "Thou inhabitest the praises of thy people." Do you realize that God is here? The one whom the angels shield their faces is here in this building, longing to hear from our heart. That is why the hymn writer could say those words, "Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Come bow before him now in reverence and fear. In him no sin is found." This morning we stand on holy ground. Be still, for the presence of the Lord is here. Firstly, a call to worship. Secondly, then, a reason to worship in verse 3. A reason to worship. "For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods." Why ought Biden? Why ought Putin? Why ought Johnson? Why ought we praise this mighty God? Well, firstly, because in verse 3, he is a great God. During David's life, he was surrounded by the pagan nations of the Philistines. They supposed that Israel's God was weak, unresponsive, a God who just sat aloof in the sky and could do nothing. And yet the psalmist refutes this idea. And he uses this word, great, to speak of someone who is remarkable, something that is out of the ordinary. For our God is a great God. He is the architect of creation. He is the Almighty One who commands the sun and the stars and the moon and the systems. And they move this morning in obedience to his great pleasure. Not only the architect, not only the Almighty One, but he is the Awesome One, the Exceeding Great One, the Exalted One, the Excellent One, the Almighty One. This morning, do you understand the greatness of your God? Sometimes we put God in a little cardboard box. We think he can only do what our imaginations can muster up. But our God is a great God, greater than Putin. And King David, who was a greater man than all of the leaders we say today, says that there is a greater one. Psalm 104, verse 1. "Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, thou art very great." Psalm 145, verse 3, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable." Psalm 150, verse 2, "Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness." Over these past 10 days, there's been a great focus on the greatness and power of Putin. Yet has any of our newspapers spoke about the greatness of God? Putin is but a grasshopper before him. He is but a speck of dust in a bucket. And this morning God sets the bounds of Putin. The king's heart is in the hands of the Lord. Child of God, have we misunderstood? Have we misapplied who God is and who what he can do? He is so great that the heavens of heavens, they cannot contain him. You know, the Bible speaks about that he has measured the heavens with a span. That means that our God this morning, he has measured the universe from his thumb to his little finger. God, he just says, that's the size of you compared to me. the greatness of our God. That is why we hold these prayer meetings. That is why we're crying on to God, because he's greater than Putin. He holds the world in his hand. He is a great God in verse 3. But he also is a great king above all gods. We now turn to heaven's royalty. He is a king. He is the one who has sovereign rights of this earth. He is the one who has authority over all creation, over Russia, over Ukraine, over Britain. He is the King of Kings and he is the Lord of Lords. Not only a great king, he's a divine king. Not only a divine king, but he is a majestic king. No one can compare to my God. So that all are obliged to praise him. To him all power is given on heaven and on earth. Why do you understand this morning? He reigns in the kingdom of nature. He reigns in the kingdom of providence. He reigns in the kingdom of darkness and damnation. He reigns in the kingdom of grace for the triumph of the church. He reigns in the kingdom of glory, the heavens of heavens, the home of the saint. Our God reigns. He is above all. Yet throughout the ages, pride has made many people, many kings, suppose themselves to be greater than what they are. Many have supposed themselves to be God. Perhaps none other than Sennacherib, an old day picture of the modern day Putin, the king of Assyria. He had not only then conquered the northern tribe of Israel, but he had his sights set on the southern tribe. He was bent on conquering Jerusalem. He had then besieged Jerusalem. In 2 Kings verse 18, Hezekiah then took all of the gold from off the temple and he presented it to Sennacherib that he might turn his back and leave Jerusalem alone. And then Sennacherib sent a messenger to Hezekiah in 2 Kings 18, and it says, "And he said unto them, Speak ye now to Hezekiah, thus saith the great king, the king of Assyria, what confidence is this wherein thou trusted?" What we have here is Sennacherib. He thought he could do what he wanted when he wanted. He thought no king would dare stand against him. And then we read in 2 Kings 19 verse 15. And Hezekiah prayed. When we see someone coming against with satanic powers against the nations, the people of God should always be a praying people. And Hezekiah prayed before the Lord and said, O Lord God of Israel, which dwellest between the cherubims, thou art the God, even thou alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth. Thou hast made the heavens and the earth. Lord, bow down thine ear and hear. Open, Lord, thine eyes and hear the words of Sennacherib, which has sent him to reproach the living God. And Hezekiah, what did he do? He acknowledged that the king of Assyria was powerful. But folks, he knew that there was a greater king, more powerful, more mighty. And that night the angel of the Lord went down into the army of Sennacherib and he slew 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. And whenever Sennacherib saw the carnage, he abandoned his conquest of Jerusalem and fled to Nineveh. You see, whenever God's people pray, and they pray against this tyrant, this man with satanic influence, Putin is no match for our king. He is no match for our mighty God. And I believe what God could do in Assyria, that our God doesn't change. Indeed, he can do it today. Why is that? Because Exodus 15 verse 18 says, the Lord shall reign forever and ever. God has stands beside the graves of many a leader. Putin is but created dust, an instrument under satanic influence. But there is one true king, King Jehovah, who says, "Vengeance is mine and recompense. Their foot shall slip in due time, for their day of calamity is at hand." Deuteronomy 32, verse 35. Not only now we look at God, he is not only a great God, he is a creator in verse 4. In his hand are the deep places of the earth. The strength of the hills is his also. He can create all things. From the deepest point of the earth, the Mariana Trench, to the deepest mountains, Mount Everest, there is no place that his hand has not carved out. And therefore, he is the Lord who is rightfully king. Notice this in verse 4. In his hand. In his hand. All of the cosmos is in his hand. You know, the Bible speaks much about the hand of God. In Proverbs 21, verse 1, it tells us the king's heart is in the hands of the Lord. As the rivers of water, he turneth it whithersoever he wanteth. But also Psalm 63, verse 8, reminds us, "My soul followeth hard after thee. Thy right hand upholdeth me." And in tough times, folks, we can be so preoccupied that we are clinging to God, that we forget that we are in God's hand, that it's not our fingernails that sustains us, but it's his loving and sustaining and upholding hand. There's a beautiful little poem, and it goes like this. God's hand that holds the ocean's depth can hold my small affairs. His hand that guides the universe can carry all my cares. Did you get that? God's hand that holds the ocean depths can hold my small affairs. His hand that guides the universe can carry all my care. Moses could say in Deuteronomy 33, verse 3, all his saints are where? They're in his hand. No one is more secure this morning than resting in the hand of God. That is why someone once says, "Put your hand in the man who stilled the water. Put your hand in the master who calmed the sea. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Beneath his watchful eye, his saints securely dwell. The hand which bears all nature up shall guard his children well." My, remember if you're struggling this morning, that you haven't got God in your hand. God has got you in his hand. He is the one that's doing the keeping. We're the one that's doing the resting. It's also in verse 5, he is the creator and owner of the sea. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. God has given the land to man, but the sea he has reserved for himself. He has given man no inheritance on it, for the sea is his. The surface of the globe is said to be 200 million square miles, and of 2/3 of that are supposed to be of water, which would be 140 million miles. Who does it belong to? It belongs to God. He made it on the third day of creation. He gathered the waters in the hollow of his hands and he poured it into the world. He tells the oceans that you come here and you come no further. He tells them, don't you overstep my command. And the sea in scripture, it often speaks of chaos, something that's uncontrollable. But my friend, the remarkable thing is he is the controller of the chaos. You might remember in Mark chapter 4, whenever the disciples were traveling across on the Sea of Galilee to the land of the Gadarenes, there came a storm, so much so that the boat was bringing in water and Jesus was asleep on a pillow. And his disciples came in and they awoke him and said, "Master, carest thou not that we perish?" And what did Jesus do? He got up and he said to those winds and the waves, he said, "Lie down like a dog." And the disciples said, "What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the waves obey him?" He is, without dispute, the owner of all. He has the power of all. The chaos in our world the chaos in Ukraine, the chaos in your life. My God has got it in his hand. By knowing that God is firstly a great God, knowing that he is a great king in verse 3, knowing that he is a great creator in verses 4 and 5, how ought we to respond? Well, we ought to worship God with reverence in verse 6. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. Let us worship this morning. Let us worship God. Let us bow down before him. Since he is the King of all glory, come and worship him. That word worship is essentially the Hebrew word meaning to bow down in humility. Like a dog would bow down to its master, he would cower in his presence. We get low before God. We become humble in his presence as we understand who we are and how holy he is. That the creature owes the creator his worship. See, it's Spurgeon writing of this passage. He says these words, "For our God is no God of lead, no God of bread, no brazen God, no wooden God. We must not fall down and worship our Lady Mary, but our Lord, not a martyr, but the Master, not any saint, but only our Savior." This morning, are you worshiping him? The great and awesome God of all glory. Worship God with reverence, but worship God with a relationship in verse 7. For he is our God, and we are the sheep of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart. There is only one way that you can truthfully worship God, in spirit and in truth. And that is by entering into relationship with him. By faith, repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Only then are we told that in verse 7, we will be the people of his pasture. Only then will we have the Lord as our shepherd. Only then will he will be able to keep us by his almighty hand. And if you are in this relationship, it's wonderful. It's beautiful, the picture that we are the sheep of his pasture. That he never takes his eye off the sheep. That he's always looking over them. His hand is always around them. But if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, then undoubtedly you're not part of his flock. But you're part of a different flock. The flock of Satan. The flock of this world. But yet today God called you to submit and to surrender your life to him. To give up the struggle, to give up the fight, and to bow in reverence to this holy God. Remember, there's a limited time in verses 7. It says today, not tomorrow, not some other day. This is the almighty voice of God, and it says today, if you will hear my voice, don't harden your heart. Get right with me. And yet if you do not, there are fearful consequences in verse 11. He swear in his wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Heaven will never be yours. Yes, your wife might go there. Yes, your father might go there, but you will never enter into it. You may wish to have this rest, but you cannot until you yield to God. And I know this morning there are perhaps some in our gathering who are not saved. And that you haven't got the peace of God in your heart. You haven't got the rest of God in your heart. And you never will. Until you bow at Calvary. And you ask Jesus to become Lord of all. And every time you hear this gospel message. And you walk away. Your heart gets that little bit harder. Your ears get that little bit deafer. And as often said, the grayer on the outside, the blacker you will become on the inside. And so I would press the importance, the necessity of bowing to the King of Kings and to the Lord of Lords, or one day you will be made to bow at the judgment seat and you will confess that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so in a world fueled by fear of Putin's power, Let us stand back this morning and remember the power of our God. He is a great God. He is a great King above all God. He is the Creator. How are we to respond? Worship God with reverence, with worship, with adoration, with holiness. Worship God in a relationship. Give your life to Him. Bow before Him. Ask Him into your life and know this promised rest one day when you join Him together in heaven. I trust this morning, folks, that you will come and that you will worship Him with all of your hearts. We're going to sing together. A familiar hymn emphasizes what we've been speaking about this morning. O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand has made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. The chorus says, then sings my soul, how great thou art, how great thou art. Let's really sing this out, emphasizing it to ourselves and to others that we really want to worship the Lord.
Yeah.
Speak, Lord, in the stillness while we wait on Thee. Hush our hearts to listen in expectancy. And as we've been listening and been reminded from Your word this morning of the Almighty God, might we not fear, as the architect of the world is in charge, the awesome one who commands the sun and the stars to shine, is the one this morning that holds us in the hollow of His hand. Oh Lord, we worship You. We exalt our great God. And we say this morning, how great Thou art. And we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.